very much, Dale, for coming here today. We've got some local things that we can talk about too, but I think foremost, Dale's our special guest. Thank you very much, and I dare say any questions throughout the session you'd be happy to receive.
Pretty informal.
Wonderful. So thank you very much, everyone, and enjoy.
In the area that we're at, has light soils. We get 7 inches of rainfall, and well, we can produce some of the highest potato yields in the U.S. and probably in the world. We get good irrigation water out of the Columbia River, and our water comes from the Canadian Rockies, glacier fed, clean water, no salt, no other issues, and so we can control what we do. And the emphasis to grow high value crops, which is pretty much the same everywhere. Before we had fumigants like metam sodium or chloropicrin or telone, and methyl bromide was always too expensive for our situations. You had a long rotation. We might be 7 or 8 years between potato crops, but now everybody wants to be 3 or 4 or less if they could. And the same way with onions and some of these other crops. So using metam sodium became a pretty common practice after the 1970s. And similar thing happened in Australia and elsewhere around the world. And the first time you use it, it's like the silver bullet, and then it never gets any better. But so you go to higher and higher rates, and it's less and less effective. But unfortunately, they're like chemotherapy on your soil. They kill the good and the bad, and the bad guys tend to repopulate better than the good guys, especially if you have low organic matter. And so to solve these issues on our farm, going back to my agronomy training, you know, we looked at stubble mulching and minimum tillage and things to try to raise the carbon level in the soil or organic matter, and we made some benefits there. But really the thing that we went back to was green manure crops. Had that's what they used to solve the dust bowl issues in the Great Plains of the United States in the 1930s. But the problem was, back then, people would grow a green manure crop for a full season, and my banker probably wouldn't think that was real prudent on our situation of high cost of land and the taxes and the water systems and all that and the equipment you got to pay for them every year. So we looked for a quick growing green manure crop that had some frost tolerance for us, because then we could harvest wheat in late summer, and we still had 60 days or so that of reasonably warm temperature, and we had some water that we could grow something. So the mustard was one, and that's one of my sons, Mike, that's involved in our farm and our seed business. So we thought if we could find a quick growing green manure crop, it was easy to incorporate. We tried doing some cereals, and we'd end up with a big sod mess, and the first trip through was pretty fast, and then it was so rough that you had to slow way down, and especially growing potatoes, that sod would end up in our potato crop, and then we'd have tear issues and ventilation problems in the storage. So we wanted it quick, easy to incorporate, and one of the big issues we wanted was the wind erosion, because our soil wasn't high in organic matter to begin with. It was maybe 0.3% of the desert sand with sagebrush on it, but it was still around 0.5%, 0.6%, and we knew that rebuilding the soil, the green manures help rebuild. Really, it's the microbes in there that kind of glue the soil particles together, increase soil aggregation. Under center pivot, these sands were shedding water because the structure was gone. And so we needed to improve our water penetration, especially under the big center pivots. The higher microbial populations, they help suppress diseases in their own. And we knew that with increasing organic matter and soil tilth, that we should see some better aeration, which potatoes like and most crops like, particularly root crop. But the suppression of disease and nematodes and weeds was kind of a new thing that researchers said, well, you know, if you're using mustard, it has a potential to biofumigate. And this is back 20 some years ago, nobody was doing biofumigation. You know, researchers were testing it. There was a project in Australia, CSIRO was involved, some work in Europe and some in the US, but really we were missing the mark on a lot of things. And the way that the pest control works in this is one, you know, crop rotation was what we typically use for a lot of years, like thousands of years. But with the green manure crop, you could add this in for 60 or 80 days, and it was really like adding a year as far as the soil was concerned to the crop rotation. So having a diverse community, hopefully you're growing things that don't host the pests that are bothering your target crops. The other thing that scientists tell us is this competitive exclusion, and that's where having this diverse microbial population, these things are antagonistic to the pests. They might even, you know, there are some of these fungi that kill nematodes and they suppress these other diseases so they can't attack the root system of your young crop. And so we know that that's an important part of, you know, the whole system. And then the third thing that they looked at in the biofumigation is it's unique to these brassicas because they have glucosinolates. And the glucosinolates, there's 120 some known glucosinolates, and there's also one enzyme in the plant called myrosinate. And they're separated by a membrane in the plant cells. And when those cells are crushed in the way God designed it, when an insect bit into that, a small amount of that enzyme would combine with the glucosinolate and the water in the plant, and it produces a volatile compound of isothiocyanate. And I think everybody here has probably experienced that. When you go to the Oriental restaurant and they bring you the egg rolls and the little dish of hot mustard, and you dip the egg roll in and you take a bite, and about 20 seconds later, your sinuses start burning. Mm-hmm. Well, that's the moisture in your mouth that activated that, and that burning is the same, in fact, the same ITC that we produced with the Caliente 199. It's the allele isothiocyanate. But one thing that's not on this chart, that there's a little bit of glucose comes off this, a little bit of sugar, and a little bit of nitrile comes off this. And so for most situations above pH 5.8, it's predominantly ITCs that are produced. But if you have low pH soil, the lower you get down into the fives, the more nitriles you produce, and the less ITC. Nitriles are good as a fertilizer, but they aren't biocidal. And so if you have pHs in the low fives, you won't get biofumigation. You'll get some of the green manure effects. And so that's always a question that we need to discuss with the grower is, what soil pH are you dealing with? If you're 5, 6, 7, or 8?
I think nitrile, that whole sheet too, like grazing is an important part of that.
And high nitriles can affect.
And high nitriles with bulk sheep.
But I'm not quite most sure. Sheep wouldn't eat this mustard because
the reason why.
They'd be starving if they did. Yeah. You'd have other problems if they were forced to eat this. So this was all well and good, but you know, we were trying to do this commercial, and for our situation, we figured if the mustard would just improve the soil, you know, rebuild our soils, you know, we could rely on the fumigants to reduce our pests, we could grow potatoes, keep the ground healthy, and everything's happy. It seemed pretty simple. But as most things in life, nothing's that simple. So we did some variety trials. We did 3 years of our own trials and leaving strips in fields where we didn't fumigate to see just what the biofumigation could do, and on our verticillium, which is a pretty tough disease, and rhizoc and pythium and some of the other issues we have, it worked pretty well. But, you know, leaving the test strip isn't real science. So after 3 years, we asked the university to come in They did replicated trials. We could measure the effect that we were having, and it was basically equal to the metan sodium. And they were still confused, but you know, we said, well, you know, we don't have to figure it out. If it works and improves the soil, and you know, and we get a better spud crop, and our banker's happy, and we're happy, and the soil's happy.
Do you find with the getting back to your varieties, do you find much variation in terms of how varieties perform in different environments, or do they, you know, if it works well here, if it works well in Washington State, it works well in California, for the same control purposes, or does it vary depending on soils and climate?
Well, it depends on the climate, and we have one Caliente 61 that. It's not as hot as the 199, you know, if you measure the concentration in the leaf. But in hot weather, it'll grow twice as much biomass. You know, and it's more dry, it'll actually go dormant. In fact, we found that out in New Zealand when we were trying to multiply this off season. We didn't have very much seed, it was a new variety, and then they planted on the only field that doesn't have irrigation. And it's the driest summer in 100 years, just our luck, on the one variety we needed the most. In fact, we looked at it in January, I guess, of that summer, and the thing was sad. Around the edges where the little snow had blown in, there was a little extra moisture. It had a little bloom, but the rest of the field looked, and we said, well, whatever there's there, take it. And, you know, I mean, if you have to pay the guy to harvest it, there's not much, but if we only get 500 pounds of seed, at least it's something to do some trialing with. And they said, you know, right after you left, it started raining, and all those spots of the field that looked dead, all of a sudden they took off and grew. Well, the Caliente 199, it would have just bolted, made seed if it was only this tall, called it a life, and it was over. So this stuff, for rain-fed situations, especially where it's warm, it's a better variety. And if it, even though it's not as hot side by side as the Caliente 199, if you can get two or three times the amount of biomass and it'll go through the moisture stress, then it's a better fit for that situation.
But the actual glucoselate. Yeah, inside the doesn't vary a great deal. If the plant's growing, the actual level of glucoselate, it doesn't change very much, or it does.
The composition of the glucosinolates, and there might be several. These ones are predominantly sinigrin that produce AITC. And there might be some other phenolic types and so on. The hotter it is, the higher they'll be, even in the same variety.
Yeah, I understand that.
And just like radish. Mm. And so they'll vary from variety, and that's why white mustard has a totally different glucosinolate that doesn't biofumigate. Or radish has glucoraphanin, and it's not volatile and it's not biocidal. So these are going to have the same chemistry, it's just the amount can vary, as well as the biomass.
Yeah, that's the question I was asking. So the actual amount, the titer in the plant, will vary depending upon the
and so this much biomass in the middle of the summer might have as much glucosinolate as this much in the fall. You know, so, and again, it's like, well, we're not in complete control. We kind of got to, you know, we deal within the practical limitations of the timing and the equipment and so on, and what the weather throws at us. So again, it's like, well, you kind of have to be your own